This would actually be more dramatic if you guys had seen what these plants look like when they're not in a garden. Why study lost crops? Honestly, at the beginning, I just thought it was an interesting fact that there were these numerous lost crops that were grown by people in this part of the world for thousands of years, and that no one knew how they were grown or why they were grown or much about them. To me, it just seemed like a kind of fascinating historical puzzle. Yeah, we're gonna be harvesting these. That's what we're gonna do today. I don't know, I might wanna, no, I mean, it's still flowering, so.
I wish I had a, I have a farmer to tell me what to do.
Yeah, but it's always tricky to figure out like when the best time to harvest this is, and it's a variable that I'm still trying to understand. People who grew these were drawing on like many generations of knowledge about what the correct way to treat them was. And so it's gonna take a long time to get to the bottom of that. So I try not to get like stuck in my ways, if that makes sense. So if I stay flexible, then maybe I'll eventually arrive at that. A lot of the populations of these plants are really just like barely hanging on because there isn't a lot of habitat left for native plants in general, but especially native weeds, because no one thinks to protect weeds.
Here's one.
There's another one, yeah. Good eye. Yeah, so this is a little stand of it. And this is always the kind of place where I find this species. Habitats where I would collect them were places like boat ramps, ditches on the side of the road, you know, like little margins along agricultural fields. In some cases, little prairie remnants and things like that. But see, it's got one longer one and then two on the sides. That's kind of how I spot it. Obviously, you need to collect seeds from plants before you can plant them and grow them. So I had to start going out and collecting seed from wild plants about 5 years ago. So I went out and did like a huge tour of the entire area where they were grown, which is basically from Appalachian, Ohio, Kentucky, and Tennessee over to the Great Plains. And I collected seed from lots of populations along the way. I don't think that when we talk about ancient agriculture, there's enough understanding of the fact that it's mostly a knowledge system. Just because people have access to seeds does not mean that they're gonna be able to then take them and grow them. I and my colleagues that are doing this, I think all are kind of motivated from the standpoint of wanting to see more diverse agricultural systems, wanting to see the knowledge and management of Indigenous people recognized. Curiosity about what the ecosystems of North America were like before we got this industrial agricultural system going here. There's more practical reasons to study them because we're looking for more crops, and the idea of domesticating new crops is becoming increasingly popular these days. It just seems like it makes sense to at least try the things that have already been tried before by people who had like such comprehensive knowledge of the environment. And now just recently, we finally had enough clean seed that we don't need all of it to plant the next year. And so I recruited this local chef who's interested in the history of cuisine in this region, especially in the Ozarks. And so when I met him, I told him, you know, we have this really rich archaeological record in the Ozarks. We know what people were eating here for thousands of years before that. And would you be interested in experimenting with these plants too?
I'm popping chenopodium seeds as if it were popcorn. Our assumption is that in the past they would have made either a gruel or a bread. So using modern technology and modern knowledge, and to me it's actually more modern tastes, you know, what people will enjoy, it made sense to go to something like popcorn because it's gonna be soft. I can add it to anything. And in fact, what I'm gonna add it to in a bit is something very sweet. So all I'm doing is tempering the chocolate. So I'm gonna put some of the puffed chenopodium in. I like to work with local ingredients because for me, it's tradition, history, culture, But it's also about economy. You know, when I look at any of the local ingredients, whether it's farmed or foraged, ultimately I'm just trying to keep that system, the ecosystem, the financial system, the community intact, even if it's just my little part of it. So here's our chocolate bars. Salty, smoky, earthy, sweet. It's perfect. The seeds are the star of the show on this one.
It's really exciting because I've been working on them for years and people are always asking me what they taste like and I didn't have an answer. So now we're starting to get an answer to that question, which is really cool. There's a debate within archaeology about why these plants were abandoned. And I guess it hasn't really been a debate because we haven't had a lot of evidence about it one way or the other. So part of the reason I wanted to quantify yield in this experiment was so that I could directly compare yield for these plants to maize for the first time and be like, what is the actual difference? So you have to think about other reasons why people might have wanted to abandon their previous way of doing agriculture in favor of a different one. And there's lots of other reasons why it could be, but I don't think it's likely to be yield.